Hello everyone, I'm Ravi from Morningstar. Welcome to yet another episode of Advisor Talks powered by ICICI Prudential Mutual Fund. And today we have with us Shweta Jain of Investography. Thanks Shweta for joining us.
My pleasure, Ravi. Thank you for having me over.
So Shweta, you started your practice about a year back, and tell us, why did you, decide to take the entrepreneurial plunge, and how has been the journey so far?
So the journey, like every entrepreneurial journey, is tough, is a lot of fun sometimes, but a lot of tears as well. So I've been in the personal finance industry for 15 years now, and after 14 and a half years at a company, I started on my own. Basically, why does anybody start anything on their own? To make sure that you have the freedom to do not just what you want to do, but also how you want to do it. And that's pretty much why I started Investography. This was not just about managing wealth for others, but it was more about educating people on how they can manage their money better. It is, we take a myopic view when it comes to investments in our industry, because this is the investment industry. But as an advisor, I like to talk to people about the money that they're earning, about the money they're spending, about the difficulties that they have when they are trying to save their money. So it's, money is a more comprehensive term than investments. So we help people manage their money, and I wanted to bring that in a different way, which is where I started.
Okay, so how's been the journey so far?
Like I said, journey is interesting. It's a lot of fun at times. It's difficult at times. But is it worth it? For me, every day is different. It's worth it. And believe it's a long-term profession, and I'm in it for the long term. I have my skin in the game.
Okay. So you have conducted, more than 1,000 financial literacy programs. So tell us, what kind of topics do you cover, and what is the kind of feedback that you get from, investors? What are their common concerns?
Right. So we do workshops for individuals who are either part of companies, so as employees, or different groups. Even if there's one person in a company who's willing to listen to us, even today I'm happy to talk to them. So the kind of workshops that we do is more driven towards the challenges people face. So for example, one of our topics that we do and is very popular is good money habits, because here we're trying to talk to people about what habits they should have when it comes to money. And these could be little things, a little difference, like when you're in a plane, right? A small degree of change can change your destination completely. So for us, it's talking to people about these little things, because I realized about 8 years ago that while everybody is focused on making money, nobody is really helping people on how to manage that money once they've started earning. And I saw more and more young people into debt. I saw more and more people struggling with various things when it comes to money. They just didn't know what to do. I know of my own close circle who were not in finance, didn't know how to write a check, didn't know what to do with their bank accounts, didn't know implications of a lot of these things. So for us, and for me particularly, that became something like a calling, where I want to help people to manage their money irrespective of what careers they choose, because we all need to deal with money. I think it's a life skill, and it's not being taught today. So that's the motivation. Topics could be anything, right? Like good money habits. We help people do retirement planning, so which is not just financial. We try and probe people into what do they want to do after they retire? What kind of life do they want to live? It's not just financial. Like everything that is around us will impact us financially. And if you don't have the money to do some of these things, it really hurts us emotionally. So money and emotion are very closely linked. So most of our workshops are not necessarily all the time talking about money. It's about what do you want to do in your life, and how money can be an enabler sometimes, or can tie you down. And we want to make sure that it's an enabler and not tying you down. So various topics. We even do workshops on regular tax planning, for a simple reason that companies have that as a mandate sometimes. And we are happy to help people save taxes. What do we do differently in these? We use these as building our credibility, not building our business. So most of the companies that we work with pay us, for the simple reason that we are not there to peddle our services or products. So we don't talk about any product there. In our tax planning workshop, we are not there to sell ELSS, for example, or we are not there to sell any particular product. We are then telling these people in a city where nobody is telling them open a PPF account. We're telling them open a PPF account. You're young, you have time on your side. Even if you're investing as low as 1,000 rupees, open that account today. Because I was somebody who did this 15 years back, and I know it helped me. And I want to make sure that people know some of these things and are able to help themselves by attending some of these things.
Right. So, coming to social media, you seem to be very active on Quora. So, how do you connect with prospects on Quora?
So, for me, social media is a way to build my brand. It's not to actually generate leads. And I'm very upfront about that, because for me, the brand Investography is much more than the business we generate. It's what we stand for, and we stand for education. We stand for helping people make the right decisions when it comes to money, when it comes to habits, and when it comes to habits about money. So we try and help people, whether it's Quora, whether it's Twitter, wherever else it is. If you see us, we are there talking about various challenges that people face when it comes to money, not just investments again. So we don't really see this as a business leading exercise, but as something that people should know, and who better than us to tell them about it.
Right. So when it comes to social media, what is the approach that advisors should be taking? You know, which kind of medium should they adopt? So there's Facebook, Twitter, and how do they go about generating content for social media?
So advisors should use a platform that they are comfortable with, first of all. And if they're not comfortable with any of these, try and see where your audience is, the audience that you want to try and connect with. Connect with them on that media, so be it Facebook, be it Twitter, be it LinkedIn, wherever it is. If you want to build your brand, build that. When you're looking at content, curate content which you think you can stand by. Whether you've written to it or not is irrelevant. If you are, for example, all for term insurance, talk about it. If there are articles that you can refer to, be it by any publication, be it by any author, share these, and share these with your prospects, with your business connects, with your family, relatives. We undermine our social skill tremendously. WhatsApp as a medium is being used for business much more than any other platform is, because you just can't avoid it today. Right, so whether I'm on Twitter or no, I'm definitely on WhatsApp. And most people are more active on WhatsApp than we'd like to. It's become more of a addiction today. And the fact that you have to reply to that message is more than any addiction could be. So WhatsApp is a great medium. Keep sharing things that you think your prospects would like to hear and what you stand by. These are the two things I think you should continue to do this. And perseverance. So you will not see conversions with one tweet or with one post. You have to be consistent, and you have to keep doing it regularly if you want to see results. I think we give up too fast. We don't give it time. Just like equity is for long term, social media or any kind of media presence for that matter, you have to be consistent, not just in your presence but in your messaging as well. So you can't keep going back and forth on anything that you believe in. Be consistent, be there regularly. Don't push, don't chase too much. I know a lot of people who've come back to us as clients after 6 months even appreciate the fact that we've not called them every week saying, what happened, you met us a few days back, and you know, are you going to sign up with us? So we don't do that. Use education as a way to generate business for you. Don't have an ulterior motive though, and be very straightforward with what you want from these posts that you do. Is it education that you want? Is it business that you want? There are ways to pursue business subtly rather than be in their face. Nobody likes a salesman today, as much as that is sad. Nobody likes a salesman, but each one of us is a salesperson, right? We're selling ourselves to the media, to people. We want people to like us, whether it's an interview, whatever it is. So if you're upfront about what you're doing, people will appreciate that more. People today appreciate honesty even more because it's scarce, right? So be honest, be clear about what you want, and I'm sure you'll have a winning strategy.
So what are the things that, you know, advisors should avoid on social media? Like you said, don't be too pushy. So what are things that they should, you know, not do on social media?
I think they should not get into trolling on social media, get into arguments, get into selling a particular scheme or a product or a fund house. They should avoid doing that. I'm aware that we all have our recommendation baskets, but you do not want to just look like you're promoting one product for the simple reason that one product will not fit all. It may be right for some people. And if you're going and putting your neck on the line for a product, tell who it is for and who it is for not. If you're going to be that clear, then definitely do that. But otherwise, I think just stay away from product recommendations and specific recommendations, because you don't know who is following what. And if your advice is being followed seriously and they get hurt in the process, I think you have to a lot to answer for, not just to them, but to yourself as well.
Right. So, you started your journey 1 year back. So, how differently are you doing your business, and, what's the roadmap that you have for your practice?
The roadmap is not very, I can say it's drawn in a lighter pencil than with a pen or like in stone. So for us, we'll go where business takes us. We know what we're passionate about. We're passionate about education. We know how we can help. So that is what it looks like. And for us, for the environment is what we want to change. Companies are not looking at financial wellness of their employees seriously. We work with a lot of companies and we want to work with them more deeply. We want more people to work with companies as well, because that's a great way for individuals to access help. Today we don't like asking for help. So when employers care about their employees, this can be a gesture for them to show that they care, because financial wellness, everybody grapples with. We think that people in the senior management are not struggling with this. We couldn't be more wrong. We think younger people who are getting into workforce are not struggling with it. They are. Everybody is struggling with it. They either don't have the time or they don't have the expertise. So in our business, for me, more as a business plan, I would like the environment to change a little bit towards financial wellness, towards literacy sessions. And I think companies should be willing to pay for something like this, because otherwise we'll always have somebody who will have an ulterior motive to do this, right? So let's let companies open up to something like this, and I think we should have a much bigger market than we are looking at today.
So Shweta, your first book as an author, My Conversations with Money. So tell us, what inspired you to write this book, and what are the key takeaways for investors?
So the book My Conversations with Money is for people who want to learn about money, for people who want to tell their money what to do for them. What inspired me is interesting. Two things. One, when I started working and I was looking for something like this to tell me what I should do with my money. Fortunately, I was in the personal finance space, but it was still difficult to understand a lot of things when I started working, right? So with this book, I want to help people to tell their money what to do, but also if they have questions, they should be able to go back to something and understand what answers or what options they have. The other reason why I wrote this book is because I believe I'm a medium to tell stories that I've heard. Like I said, a lot of workshops that we do, we have conversations with people about their money. And the more and more stories I heard, I understood that people have similar issues, but they all feel that they are alone in that, that nobody else has these difficulties like they do. So with this book, I wanted to tell their stories. I wanted them to know that they're not alone. I want them to know how other people have gotten out of issues like that. One of these may work for them. So those are two reasons. And for me, I felt a very strong pull on reporting these stories. So more than anything, as much as I'd like to take the credit for writing the whole book, I'm, I think, a medium to tell these stories. And that's why I want people to read this. Simple things like saving first versus saving later, how it could have a material impact on their complete lives, not just their financial lives, how they can actually trick their minds into simple hacks and deal with their own insecurities or deal with their own difficulties with money. Is paying off a home loan better, or is investing that bonus better? People have been grappling with these questions. Some of those questions the book attempts to answer. Of course, not everything is right for everybody, so they have to pick and choose where they relate to. The book is more of an easy read. I've been told, I don't know if to take this as a compliment or otherwise, I've been told it's more like fiction and that it's an easy read. People have finished this within 5 hours, and I'm I'm happy. I want to take this as a compliment, because if talking about money is so easy, I'm sure everybody could do that. I want these to be conversations with families, because I come from a Marwari family. So for us, money is always a conversation at dinner table. But I know today a lot of families avoid these conversations. I want people to have conversations with money with their families. So that was the whole idea of writing the book.
All right. So we wish you all the best and good luck for your practice. Thanks so much for sharing your valuable insights. For Morningstar, I'm Ravi. Thanks for watching.
Thank you.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.